Thank you. Welcome to worship.
Okay. Welcome, everybody. This is Dolores Broberg. And it looks like a fine day out here. I understand it's cold. I would like to give the saying that we used when I lived in Maine and went to the church there, because it fits us so well too. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on your journey, you are welcome here. Now, before we center into worship, I would like to draw your attention to a few announcements about upcoming events. They are included and well described in this bulletin. However, I want to highlight their dates because they all need some preparation for you to take an active part in them. On a number of Monday evenings in October and November, some of us are discussing Sister Joan Chittister's book, The Ten Commandments, Laws of the Heart. We've just begun, so it's not too late to join us. Sister Joan's insights and perceptions for achieving a life well lived in the midst of these turbulent times are inspiring. And what she has to say pairs well with her efforts to become a congregation which is truly welcoming. Now, on that subject, I'd like to point you to two events which the Conversations on Race Committee is preparing. We have already begun our work towards becoming an anti-racist congregation with our racial audit. And on Sunday, November 1st, our worship service will prepare us for the next leg of that journey, our One Book, One Church discussion. We hope you will use the time between November 1st and November 29th to get and read Ibram Kendi's thoughts in How to Be an Anti-Racist. I found them enlightening, alternately provocative and heartening, but always delivered with compassionate regard for his readers. Do look forward to the discussion, which will go forth as part of a creative service of worship on November 29th. Believe me, you won't want to miss any part of this great opportunity. Finally, in whichever way makes you more comfortable, if you've not done so already, be sure to vote. Urge your family, friends, neighbors, and colleagues to vote too. Have I missed anything? Yeah, again, the reminder, if you have business with a church that is not part of the daycare or the natural creativity only, use the office door. Thank you. So now, yeah, now, next Sunday, Bob Coombs is preaching, and we'll be continuing our conversations and all things. In the Adult Academy, we're going to go on further with our second session on how to be nonviolent in the face of a possible coup. So come and join us then. So now let's go to the acknowledgement. As a faith congregation, we acknowledge that this is a pivotal moment in American history and that our mission is clearly laid out in the gospel of Jesus. We acknowledge our mission to seek justice for Black and Brown people of all genders and orientations, to dismantle systems of bias and racism, to call out those who protect the power of state-sponsored violence against Black and Brown bodies, and re-center the voices of the marginalized of our community and society. We acknowledge our part in perpetuating white norms of language, style, worship, behavior, and culture. And with the guidance of the Holy Spirit, we acknowledge the truth that Black lives matter. In addition, we wish to acknowledge that this service of worship is being held on the traditional lands of the Lenné, Lenape people, and we pay respect to elders past and present. We affirm the sacredness of Native people, their languages, their cultures, and their gifts to the church and to the world. Now, as we allow the prelude to wash over us, thank you. me now in the call to worship. As we gather to worship you, O Holy One,
show us your presence, O God.
As we join to pray at your footstool, Exalted One,
show us your ways, O God.
As we unite our voices to praise you, Lover of Justice,
show us your glory, O God.
As we tremble in the cleft of the rock, silently waiting you, Merciful One,
show us your goodness, O God.
Let the earth shake in your praise, Most High.
We extol your great and awesome name, ever-present God. Join me now in our morning prayer. God of mercy, we place our trust in tangible things, things we can see and touch, and question whether you are really there. Forgive us, Holy One, when we fail to recognize that you are always nearby, patiently awaiting for us to recognize your presence and your glory. Help us when we lose our way, and forgive us when we forget to whom we truly belong. lover of justice, open our eyes to see you. Open our ears to hear you. Open our hearts to love you. And open our hands to serve you. So welcome each other. Welcome the stranger. Welcome all who come, as Christ welcomed everyone, no matter what their background, no matter what their social status, as Christ welcomed enemies and friends, outcasts and leaders, foreigners and neighbors. Let us open our hearts and homes and lives. Let us be Christ to everyone we meet. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
There may be some people in your breakout room who are not comfortable unmuting for one reason or another, so we need to be sensitive to the fact that everyone's circumstances may be different. Thank you.
Hi, everybody.
Oh, Barbara Ruth, hello.
Hello.
Hi there. Good morning.
Morning.
Hello. Oh, who we have? We have Gabe.
Hi, Gabe.
Stan.
Stan.
Les.
I forget who this is.
And who's on the phone?
Who did? We had somebody on the phone.
They might not want to speak, though. Yeah. Hi, everybody. I got your email this morning, Jan.
Oh, good. Yeah, great minds work.
I didn't see it.
Yeah, well, no, I emailed Barbara late last night saying, oh, yeah, are you doing the stewardship talk today?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that one. Okay.
That one. Oh, boy, I'll tell you.
She has it all printed out, and she and Bev have it organized. It's good.
I'm glad. Well, I'm here and waiting. I look forward to it.
Well, Dave, how's it feel doing a sermon without having a Bible study in front of you?
I found myself missing the Bible study because I think that you all could have said a lot with this passage.
Well, we missed it too.
Yes, we missed.
Were, I mean, it couldn't be helped because it was right in the middle of the conference, but we missed it anyway.
Yeah. Speaking of the conference, Stan, I saw you many times in the service because you were on the side, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, you were there.
Yeah, those three were there.
Yeah. Well, let me share about that. I had the privilege of being a sponsor for the person that was ordained after Tammy.
The very Julius, last person.
Julius Singleton, who was grew up at Juniata where Clarita's dad served. So he baptized her. And then she came to Fox Chase when I was at Fox Chase, and she was in college doing a public relations degree. And we needed a worker in our office, and she was looking for a part-time job. So long story short, we got to work together, and she was just, her heart was just in the work of the church. And so I said to her one day at the copying machine, "Have you ever considered ministry as a vocation?" And she said, "Well, yeah," she actually had. So long story short, we did an internship the following summer, and she responded to the call to ministry. So her ordination took place on Wednesday. So that was pretty exciting. Because I'm having a hard time getting around, I was back and forth with the committee on how I could manage. I figured there'd be steps, and it's a little difficult sometimes for me to get up and down steps with my cane. So it worked out. Long story short, no steps.
And, very good.
Yeah, it was cool.
Congratulations, yeah. Stan. That's great.
That was neat.
Tammy said she was shaking like a leaf.
Really?
Oh, you would have never known that. She's right. So outwardly so calm. And she was so pleased to see us as representatives of FOMCOG. It was just really neat.
Who was she sponsored by?
Oh, golly.
Oh, it doesn't matter. Never mind. It's yeah, okay.
Two folks that I don't know very well, but okay. She obviously, they were highlight people very in nice. Her life. Yeah.
Very nice.
It was a great service, even though it was very unusual.
Oh, that sermon was just, oh.
Yeah.
Lovely. Lovely. Yeah. Too bad we couldn't see her face.
Will it be available at some point?
Yeah, it's on the conference website now.
Good, good.
Yeah, you can see all of it.
Oop, where is everybody?
We're here.
Okay. Okay, all right. All right.
I'm missing a few, but
let me know.
I think it's safe to go ahead.
Let us continue our service with a contemporary reading, The Journey by Mary Oliver. One day you finally knew what you had to do and began, though the voices around you kept shouting their bad advice, though the whole house began to tremble and you felt the old tug at your ankles. Mend my life, each voice cried. But you didn't stop. You knew what you had to do, though the wind pried with its stiff fingers at the very foundations, though their melancholy was terrible. It was already late enough, and a wild night, and the road full of fallen branches and stones. But little by little, as you left their voice behind, the stars began to burn through the sheets of clouds, and there was a new voice, which you slowly recognized as your own, that kept you company as you strode deeper and deeper into the world, determined to do the only thing you could do, determined to save the only life that you could save.
I'm not sure what's going on because it's a large file. I'm going to try and find that file on my computer and we'll find it another way. Church.
Bless the Lord, my soul. Bless the Lord, my Lord. Bless the Lord, my soul. Bless the Lord. Thank you.
Good morning. Today's scripture passage comes from the book of Exodus, the 33rd chapter. Moses said to the Lord, "See, you have said to me, 'Bring up this people,' but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, 'I know you by name,' and you have also found favor in my sight. Now, if I have found favor in your sight, show me your ways so that I may know you and find favor in your sight. Consider too that this nation is your people." He said, "My presence will go with you and I will give you rest." And he said to him, "If your presence will not go, do not carry us up from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people, unless you go with us? In this way we shall be distinct, I and your people, from every people on the face of the earth." The Lord said to Moses, "I will do this, the very thing that you have asked, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name." Moses said, "Show me your glory, I pray." And he said, "I will make all goodness pass before you, and will proclaim before you the name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But," he said, "you cannot see my face, for no one shall see me and live." And the Lord continued, "See, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Life is full of paradoxes. In fact, I don't think it would be far-fetched to say that life itself is a paradox. Many of us are alive, but we may not know why. We may not even feel alive at times. I wrestle with the fact that in order for something to live and to remain alive, something else must usually be consumed or die. Life and its mysteries drove the philosophers of Western civilization mad, so much to the point that one philosopher named Descartes concluded that in order for him to believe anything, he must first doubt everything. Doubt in order to believe. What a paradox. Or one of the most famous ancient Western philosophers, someone who gave me many headaches as I read his works in college, the great Socrates himself, concluded that he knew one thing beyond the shadow of a doubt. He knew that he knew nothing. If we were still in the summer months and continuing our Images of God series, today's sermon would be about imaging God as paradox. Not because God is inconsistent, unreliable, or utterly transcendent, but simply because God is God. I've come to learn in my 4 years of theological studies in undergrad and my 3 years of even deeper theological study during my graduate work, on top of being a pastor for over 3 years, that God is still a mystery to me. Yet the paradox about this is that in this paradox and mystery about God, this is what ultimately leads me to trust and have faith in God all the more. So how do I trust a God whom I have never seen face to face? How do I have faith in God when there is still so much evil in the world? When racism prevails? When trees and forests are being burnt down due to climate change? When fear-mongering is the key to manipulating the masses? When families are being separated, children are being caged, people are dying of thirst and of hunger? When the news has become so synonymous with violence, violence and violence. And when my own life is falling apart. How? How do I trust when fear has crept up on me in the ways that fear does? Subtly. It presents itself as an ally, as something to trust and hold on to for protection. That's a paradox, isn't it? Fear as something to trust or grasp onto. But this isn't true. And thankfully, I recently read that the opposite of fear is not hope. The opposite of fear is faith. I can believe. I can trust, I can know God because of faith. Nature is humbling. I remember reading about survival of the fittest in my biology class and how the strongest would survive due to their adaptability. But what wasn't mentioned or wasn't emphasized is the interdependence and interconnectedness of life. In order for all animals to live, whether it's land, air, sea, or us as human beings, we all depend on plant life. And plants depend on the sun. We depend on photosynthesis to occur. We depend on the sunlight to initiate reactions in plants between carbon dioxide and water in order to produce oxygen and glucose, what we breathe and eat. This concept that it's not about me or I, that it's about us, is such a beautiful one. In the brilliance of African philosophy, the term Ubuntu has arisen as a term that emphasizes that I am because we, sisters, brothers, siblings, because we are. The more I want to advance the me or the I, the more I realize that I need others and social connection in order to truly flourish. I am because we are. This reminds me of when God says to Moses, I will proclaim before you the name the Lord. Which if we were reading this in Hebrew, we would see that the name that God proclaims is not actually the Lord. It's not the Hebrew word Adonai. But instead, it is the holy name of God that is spelled with the letters Yud, He, Vav, He. A name that many Jewish traditions would not dare to name, which is why it is substituted with the Lord. Yet when God first presented God's self to Moses, God introduced God's self as I am who I am. Well, who is God? Who is God in light of this interaction with Moses? What does this narrative tell us? I can tell you that this narrative is full of paradox. We enter into a dialogue between Moses and God. And up until this point, as you might recall, the Hebrew people have been delivered from slavery. They have crossed a sea by land. They have eaten bread that descended from heaven. They have bickered, they have grumbled, they have been awestruck. And most recently, right before this passage, they created a golden calf to worship because of their fear. Their fear that God and Moses had abandoned them after not hearing from Moses for a long time. So they create a golden calf and begin to worship it. And so God is furious with the Israelites. And this is why I love the Old Testament, because so much of it is a wild story. It's a narrative where God and God's people are inextricably bound by this complicated, hurtful, yet covenantal, steadfast, loving relationship. So there's a reason why Moses asks God to consider God's people. There's a reason why Moses asks God to not only accompany him, but also for God's presence to accompany God's people. And that reason is because God is angry. God is angry. God feels betrayed. To some extent, God might even felt abandoned. The people who God loves have decided to choose fear over faith. They've decided to doubt rather than believe. And so they worship a golden calf. And the result is that God is angry and God is hurt. I imagine that this is how God feels when I choose my fears and anxieties rather than faith in God. When I choose comfort over helping others, when I choose money or financial security over serving the least of our siblings. Because this means that I am seeking security elsewhere. This might be why, more than any other phrase in the entire Bible, God says to God's people time and time again, do not fear. Do not fear. Prior to this passage, God disappointingly tells Moses, go on, continue your journey into the promised land. I'll send an angel with you, but I won't go with you, because if I go with you, I'll consume you, because you are a stiff-necked people. You are stubborn. Like any relationship that faces betrayal, there is anger and sadness. This is a paradox. A God who is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love is also one who is on the verge of consuming God's people. Is God contradicting God's self? It may seem like that. But what I find most intriguing in this passage is the insights that it gives us into theological anthropology. There is a direct interrelation between God and God's people. God is hurt that the Israelites would choose something else other than God. And God is so hurt and angry to the point where God considers abandoning them and taking time and space away from them. But God needs a reminder of God's covenant with Abraham. And that reminder comes from Moses. So herein lies the paradoxical mystery that I present to you this morning. Whether we believe it or not, this passage seems to suggest that there is a codependent and interdependent relationship between God and humanity. Without God, the Israelites die in the wilderness. They die of hunger. They die of thirst. Without Moses and God's reminder of God's covenant, God would end up consuming God's people while simultaneously breaking God's covenant. What's the lesson here? The lesson is that we need God. And to a certain extent, God needs us. Moses knew that if God did not go with them, they were doomed. He says, if your presence will not go with us, do not carry us up from here. What's interesting is that the Hebrew word for presence literally means face. Moses is saying to God, if your face doesn't go with us, do not carry us up from here. Interestingly enough, God says to Moses later on, no one shall see my face and live. By the end of the story, though, God grants Moses' requests. God's presence continues to accompany the Israelites. And God appears to Moses, but Moses is only able to see the back of God as Moses hides behind the cleft of a rock, as all of the goodness of God passes by him. What a powerful visual. I wonder what it might mean to see God and all of God's goodness today, in light of everything that's happening in the world. Friends, we are on the verge of an unprecedented time in the history of the world. There is a virus that is plaguing our world and continues to claim lives. And as you know, racism is still alive and well. The earth is sending us warning signs that it is under great and significant distress from human-caused pollution. There is an important election coming up. So, in light of all these things, what might it mean for us to turn to God during these unusual times? What might it mean to pray to God and remind God of God's covenant with us? What might it mean to ask for wisdom in a path where we can turn away from fear, turn away from fear and division and hate, and turn toward faith, unity, and love? I now understand that the people who fought so arduously to bring about peace in the times of hate and division did so by letting go of fear and placing their faith in love. Even God embraces this paradox in this story, because God chooses love. Even though God is angry and may be inclined to destroy God's people, God chooses to remember that God loves God's people. So friends, let's choose love today. Let's choose love today and every day. For it is only through having faith in love that we can overcome our fears and hate. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Family and friends of Reverend James McIntyre, Charlene Siegel, David Pearson, brother-in-law of Bruce McNeil, Gabriella Reeses, George Harold, Karen Clark, Kimberly Chalmers, Linda Brown, family of Doreen Emmerich, Lorraine Henson, Ray Sveen, Rolf Brockovich, Suzanne Moeller, Melinda Snover, and John Tyson, with their marriage.
In July of 2018, long before the present season, John Pavlovitz posted this message on his blog, Stuff That Needs to Be Said. It was entitled, An Open Letter to Those Who Still Give a Damn. I stumbled upon this last week, and I've adapted most of his words in today's prayer. These are, by and large, his words. The pronouns have been changed to include us all. Dear God, it's exhausting to give a damn, isn't it? Lord, why on earth did you fashion us to give a damn? To be a congregation of compassion in a time when compassion is in such great demand. To wake up every day in days like these and push back against extrajudicial killings and burning forests and hurricane flattened coastlines and pandemic surges and predatory politicians and human rights atrocities and acts of treason and spiritual leadership failures and presidential tantrums, the volume and the relentlessness of the threats can be wearying. We are weary. You may have noticed, Lord. We pray that you have noticed. And we're not simply carrying around these big picture, larger systemic sicknesses and political realities, but the people behind them, the names and the faces and the lives of specific human beings who are under unprecedented duress right now. People whose stories we listen to and know and are living within. People we dearly love. Lord, why on earth do you invite us to give a damn? It seems like fewer and fewer people are capable of even an entry-level empathy for the suffering around them. And we're seriously considering joining their ranks because of how tired we are of carrying both our own and their share of compassion for a hurting humanity. We're not sure why we're praying to you, Lord, but it's probably because we're still damn givers, because we are fierce lovers of humanity and of the planet and of people who don't look or worship or sound like us. As a result, we probably find ourselves pissed off, disconnected, isolated, worn out, and exhausted because of how few people are as moved by the need around them as we are. But Lord, what use is it for us to give a damn? There's a cost to compassion, a personal price tag to cultivating empathy in days when cruelty is trending. There is in our bodies and heads and in our midst a collateral damage to us giving a damn when others do not. And it manifests itself in many ways, in irritability, impatience, physical illness, eating emotionally, addictive behavior, the inability to be present to the people who love us, an obsession with social media, a fixation on how jacked up everything is. Lord, you know we're exhausted. If we're not exhausted right now, our empathy is busted. But through your love, we are assured that we aren't alone. Millions of people are as tired as we are right now, but still give a damn. We too feel the fatigue of believing we're doing this damn giving alone, but we are in good company. So we resolve by faith to keep going. Help us fight like hell to keep our hearts soft, even when so many people have become hardened. Yes, this world is upside down right now, but in your name, we can make it right, one beautiful act of decency at a time. We just stopped by here to get some rest and keep going. Blessed are the dam givers, for we will right side the world. Amen. And now, from the words of John Pavlovich to the words of Jesus, we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church family. I've been asked to talk a couple of minutes about why I love, like, attend Funcog. I grew up in a traditional African-American Episcopal Zion, African Methodist Episcopal Zion church that I didn't always feel comfortable in. Went off to undergraduate school to a Methodist church three times a week in chapel. Didn't particularly feel comfortable with the chaplain, and I actually had a word or two on occasion. Left the church for quite a while. Didn't attend at all in grad school and law school, and found myself needing church again when I moved here. So I went church shopping, and I was friends with someone who became a bishop of the UM church and attended his church for a while, but it felt too much like my traditionalist home church, so I stopped going. Was introduced to FUMCOG by Rose Chapman. Attended for quite a while, sat in the back of the church, attended service, and then left immediately after. Used to sit with Vernon and Pat Loeb, often holding their little girl on my lap. Somebody approached me one day, one of the members, I can't remember who anymore, just to stay for coffee hour. So I did, and started meeting people. I didn't meet a lot of people who looked like me, but I did meet folks who thought like me. I was from the South and a child of the 60s, and I thought myself a social warrior up from the South. Someone introduced me to some of the social justice groups in the church, and I became involved. As a Christian, I was sometimes and am still sometimes a doubter. I made a lot of good lifelong friends at this church who are also doubters, but still faithful, which I found an interesting paradox. Ultimately, from a doubter, I became a scouter. I joined with Anne Perrone in helping this church build the only scouting program in Germantown, working with kids from several socioeconomic backgrounds. And as Anne always preaches, scouting is not an activity, but a movement, a program building healthy adults from some healthy and sometimes not so healthy, broken youth. So I found a purpose here at FUMCOG with lifelong friends who doubt, but also believe with me. So if your family and friends, if you found family, friends, and have faith and doubt, and have faith in, but as Grape says, have faith in love, please support FUMCOG as you are able. Thank you.
I wanted to do this with Bev. This is Barbara. I wanted to do this with Bev because for the past 2 years, we've been meeting together every Wednesday at 7 a.m. for breakfast before the pandemic sent us to Zoom for what we call Bible study. I've been grateful to Bev and have learned from her experience and knowledge and insights and her commitment to FUMCOG's missions and the neighborhood. So this is going to be personal. I want to emphasize two things that have been central to my life since I joined FUMCOG about 25 years ago. Now, I know that's not much in comparison to a good many of you, but over this time, FUMCOG has encouraged me to participate in the church's programs that have enabled me to grow both spiritually and intellectually. And like Bev, I have made lifelong friends. The first thing I participated in was the Civil Rights History Tour for 10 days of visiting major civil rights places throughout the South. This then got me into the Religion and Race Committee, which is now Conversations on Race, and helping to work towards making FUMCOG a more anti-racist organization. Now, life at FUMCOG has been eventful. After I retired from the School District of Philadelphia, I began to work with the newly started after-school program. I was here every day with between 25 and 40 students from Germantown High School. I think the one crucial thing we should remember from this 13-year-long project is that we helped over 800 students graduate on time from a school that had under a 50% graduation rate. Now, this work has put me on the administrative council, on which I still participate. But working on religion and race and with my friend Sylvia Bolden got me involved with the International Linger Lunch on Worldwide Communion Sunday. What was wonderful about this was it was the one time during the year that we made oral contact with every member of the church to invite everyone to celebrate the incredible feast in which everyone brought food. Now, we're going to get back to this in 2021 after this pandemic is over. And a few years ago, I became a trustee, and I learned how critical this group is to supporting the activities of our social, racial, economic justice programs, our music, and the day-to-day operation of the church. I was able to join our original sanctuary group to discover in Guatemala some of the work FUMCOG does to support indigenous people and to be companions to Gabriela in a trip back to see her families. And of course, we would be a sanctuary church again. And did you know that FUMCOG has a book group and that we've read and discussed well over 100 books together, exploring worldwide cultures and history through fiction and nonfiction? But for me and for Ruth, the pièce de résistance has been the support you lavished on us as we were trying to be married in this reconciling church. Pastor Lorelei arranged for us to be married nearby, allowing her to be part of the service without being charged for performing a same-sex wedding. Neither of us have family here, but you all gathered and marched up Germantown Avenue with our church doves to be our wedding guests and family. And now we have a joint service with Germantown Mennonite Church every Sunday between Christmas and New Year's to commemorate our wedding. I said it was personal, but this is true for each of you. FUMCOG is so big that there's a place for everyone to participate and to grow. FUMCOG invites you to use your skills and develop new ones. This year with Conversations on Race, we will be learning new things. There's something for everyone, big jobs, little jobs, long-term, short-term. As Gabe said in his sermon this morning, this is not about I, but it's about us and loving relationships between God and us. Please add service as well as funding to your stewardship pledge this year. And thank you, FUMCOG.
Thank you for those witnesses. And Barbara and Ruth, I'm happy to share that I've been in conversation with the people at Germantown Mennonite Church, and we are going to continue the tradition online online this year, joining in a Zoom service together. They have a new minister, Kate, who I have not yet met, who will preach and will be the host congregation. So the tradition you started with the love you have for each other and celebrate that continues. So if we had read the scripture for this day from the lectionary, we would have heard Jesus being asked by a lawyer, to whom should we pay taxes, to Caesar? And Jesus, of course, answered, give unto Caesar what is Caesar's and to God what is God's. To which Dorothy Day, millennia later, said, if we give all to God what we're to give to God, we'll have nothing left to give to Caesar. So Jesus invites us, all the East, in the spirit of what we just heard from the witness for stewardship, to render to God the things that are God's. The community we share, the love we share, the witness we make, the presence of God, as we heard in Gabe's great sermon. So may our offering reflect the gifts that we give, the presence that we share, and the service that we embark on. Let us pray. God, source of all that is, lover of justice, source of equity, help us live boldly and truthfully as we seek to follow your ways. Embolden us to share with others the gift of grace that you have so abundantly given us. Receive and bless these gifts that we return to you now. In the name of the one who gives us life, we pray. Amen.
People of God, receive this blessing this morning. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make God's face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up God's countenance upon you and give you peace. May the peace of God be with you on this Sunday. And let us always work towards choosing love. Go in peace. Amen.